So I, over the last number of years, have been able to go to the Middle East maybe 15, 20 times. I don't know, something like that. I am definitely not an expert on the region, but I've observed some things. One of the first times I went, someone said to me something that's been really helpful and kind of just stuck in my mind. They said, after a week here, you want to write a book. After a month here, you want to write a pamphlet. After a year here, you're not really sure what to write. So I want to do the play on words. It's not behind the scenes, behind the screens. And this is probably dating me. Some of you have probably never even seen Wizard of Oz. But, you know, they go to see the wizard. And then at the end, there's this pulling back of a screen. And the wizard is not what they think it is. It's very different. So that's what I want to do, is just kind of pull back some screens that I've observed. The first one is the popular culture screen. Now, I grew up in the era of the Cold War. And the Cold War was when there was a thing called the Soviet Union. And so in all the action movies, the bad people were always from the Soviet Union. Then in 1989... something that cataclysmically changed many things was the Berlin Wall fell. And all of a sudden, shortly after, there's not even a Soviet Union anymore. So you need new bad people for your movies. Where do you get those? Well, you get those predominantly from the Middle East and Arab and Muslim cultures. And that shapes the way we see what we see in the region. Another screen that I've observed is the language screen, the Middle East. Now, the Middle East is a term that's used all the time. I used it in my title, right? 1850 is probably the first time it was used by the British India Office. And it was used kind of in juxtaposition to the Far East, which was, you know, Asia, where they had some things going on. In 1902, it was popularized by American naval strategist. And then by the end of World War II, there's actually the Middle East Institute in Washington, D.C. And so it's just the term that's used, but it is really not at all accurate. This part of the world is Southwest Asia. But if I said, I'm going to talk to you about Southwest Asia, you would be trying to figure out where in the world is he even talking about? So we use the Middle East. More complicated than that are this set of terms. The West Bank and Gaza, the occupied territories, the Palestinian territories, Palestine, Judea, and Samaria. Now, all of those terms actually all refer to the same piece of land for the most part. It's just the term you use is dependent on kind of your perspective on what it is. The two at the bottom of the list would probably be the most maybe inflammatory. Palestine, if you say, I'm talking about Palestine, Israel and Palestine, what you are doing is you would be assigning either nationhood or near nationhood state. And so for a lot of the world, that's like, oh, that's way too far. The government of Israel, because they for sure don't want to talk about occupied territories or things like that, their term that they use is Judea and Samaria. And tour companies there, they must use that term. They can't use the other terms. There's other terms here like democracy. Now, we have kind of a version of democracy, and democracies are different around the world. What we have to understand is that the democracy that's present in Israel is complicated, it's a word that fits almost all of what we talk about there, because it is also a Jewish state. So what about the 20% of Israelis that are Israeli citizens, but they happen to be Arabs or Palestinians? There are things they can't do. There are jobs they can't get. And so it's a unique form of democracy. the political screen. On the way in today, I just heard that the United States has just decided that, you know, there's been this whole thing with the Gaza war, and because of the destruction and the loss of life, there's been some pressure on the United States to reduce the amount of military arms that they are giving. And there was a clause in there tying arms to aid, and so the target is 350 truckloads of aid per day. And right now there's under 80 that are getting in, and so there's some people that thought maybe it would be dialed back, but the United States has said that no, in fact, they do see signs, positive signs. They're going to be opening another border crossing into Gaza, so more aid will get in. So they're not going to limit aid at this point. I want you to listen to this statement. What I ask of the United States is to be not diplomatic, but frank. I fail to understand why they are so apprehensive of speaking out and saying that the present policy of annexation will miscarry, that it is bound to fail, that it will end in national bankruptcy, or that it is suicidal. By such diffidence, Americans do a disservice to Israel and to themselves. Now that sounds like, that you can maybe kind of tell, that is an Israeli, that is a Jewish Israeli that's made that statement, but you're probably thinking to yourself, well, it must be one of the peace groups or something like that. No, this statement is actually from 1986. This is part of the complexity, is that we think of what goes on there. We think of what we hear on the news as being one uniform thing, and everybody thinks the same. This is by Yehoshaphat Harkabi, who was the military intelligence advisor to Prime Minister Menachem Begin, who was a very hawkish prime minister. And he makes this statement in 1986. And if you read his book, and he's talking about the Palestinian Liberation Organization back then, but if you take that out and put things from today, his book reads like it's being written today. The theological screen. Now, the most gnarly thing that you have to kind of decide is, what is the relationship between the state of Israel today and Israel of the scripture? Is 1948 and 1967, those are two wars that brought the thing into being, represent one of the greatest fulfillments of prophecy? I know many people that say that. Maybe there's some in this room who say that is it. If you take that perspective, then what about the rest of scriptures? What do we do with the requirements that are made of God's nation and God's people? I was at a conference over there once, and Eric Asherman, who is a rabbi, spoke, and he was asked, what do you think, as a rabbi, as a person who emigrated to Israel, what do you think the boundary of Israel, where should the borderline be? He said something very honest. He said, well, as a rabbi, I'm committed to scripture. And as I study the scripture, I see that there are requirements of God's people and God's nation. And so as such, he said that I look at it and I look at scripture and the story of scripture. And he said, I would say our boundaries today should be smaller than they are, not larger. It's kind of interesting when you hear someone say that. What is our theology of John 3:16? Is there an asterisk that said God loves the whole world except not the Middle East because it's too screwed up? It's too bad? And yet much of what we read and much of Christian literature today, particularly evangelical Christian literature, would lead you to believe that's really what is believed. What do we say about the image of God when we think about this part of the world? Are they really created in our image? When a politician said, let's bomb them back to the Stone Age, is that okay? Because that's a solution? Is making Gaza a parking lot because it gets rid of the problem? How does that fit with our belief that all people are created in the image of God? So just some maybe simple steps to move forward. First of all, we've got to come to the point where we can actually appreciate the complexity. As soon as you hear someone on TV, as soon as you're a politician giving a little 30-second answer to something that's going on there, you should just turn it off and look somewhere else. I want to encourage you to look for other news sources, particularly, frankly, not from the West. BBC is pretty good. 24 France, particularly with their connection to North Africa, is pretty good. Al Jazeera, that sounds, a lot of people say, ooh, that sounds really scary. It means the peninsula. It's not scary at all. It just means the peninsula. It is state-run. It has a bias. It's Qatar, the government of Qatar is behind it. But they have very good news. I think that for people of faith, we have to start with good theology. I'll go back to, what is our image of God? What do we do with Jesus saying, love your enemies and pray for them? Do we just say that's a throwaway statement? Do we say, well, you know, he was kind of a nice guy, but that's not realistic? I have heard one pastor who asked his congregation, do you think Jesus was serious? And the majority of people in a small group discussing that said, he couldn't have been serious. You can't do that. Where are we at on that? Again, have nuanced discussions about this. There is no, this is the good side and this is the bad side. It's really mixed up. It's like we are. And let's just take our complexity and allow it to be there. I highly encourage you to build a relationship with someone from the region. You know, you will find people from the region that are here. They might be at a restaurant. They might be in Walmart. One time my wife was in Walmart. It was during Ramadan. And she just said to one of the women who, it was very obvious that she was a Muslim woman. And she said, so what are your childhood memories of Ramadan? And by the end of about a five-minute thing, there were like six people around, and they all wanted to talk about what they remembered from Ramadan. It was everything from, it was really hard, I was a kid, and it was super hot, and not being able to eat and drink was terrible, to, we didn't really do it, but we had a big feast, to, I started doing it, and it's been an important part of my life, all my life. And the last thing I would say is just if you're visiting, try to go beyond tourism. Try to go behind the screen that they will put up on a typical tourist visit. I have a few friends I've been able to meet over the years. And they both say, one is a Palestinian Israeli citizen. His name is Johanna. He says this, he says, what you need to know about me is that I love Benjamin Netanyahu because he is a child of God. I do not love his policies, but I love him. And then I want you to meet my friend Lisa, who as a 60s living off the grid person came to Christ and knew that she was and her husband were supposed to move to Israel, and so they emigrated there. And she says this, I pray for the captor as much as I pray for the captive. Thank you.